Simon & Schuster Audio presents The Blackthorn Key, written by Kevin Sands, read by Ray Panthaki.
A warning. The recipes and remedies in this book were used by real apothecaries. There's a reason we don't see them anymore. Some are devious, some are dangerous, and a few are just plain deadly. So, as they say, don't try this at home. Seriously. Thursday, 28th of May, 1665. Ascension Day.
I found it. Master Benedict said he wasn't the least bit surprised. According to him, there were several times over the past 3 years when he was sure I'd finally discovered it. Yet it wasn't until the day before my 14th birthday that it came to me so clearly I thought God himself had whispered in my ear. My master believes occasions like this should be remembered. So, as he ordered, I've written down my formula. My master suggested the title. The Stupidest Idea in the Universe, by Christopher Rowe, apprentice to Master Benedict Blackthorn, apothecary. Method of manufacture. Snoop through your master's private notes. Find a recipe, its words locked behind a secret code, and decipher it. Next, steal the needed ingredients from your master's stores. Finally, and this is the most important step, go to your best friend, a boy of stout character and poor judgment equal to your own, and speak these words. Let's build a cannon. Chapter 1. Let's build a cannon, I said. Tom wasn't listening. He was in deep concentration, tongue pinched between his teeth as he steeled himself for combat with a stuffed black bear that ruled the front corner of my master's shop. Tom stripped off his jerkin and flung it heroically across the antimony cups gleaming on the display table near the fire. From the oak shelf nearest to him, he snatched the glazed lid of an apothecary jar, Blackthorn's wart be gone, according to the scrawl on the label, and held it on guard, a miniature ceramic shield. In his right hand, the rolling pin wobbled threateningly. Tom Bailey, son of William the Baker, was the finest fake soldier I'd ever seen. Though only 2 months older than me, he was already a foot taller and built like a blacksmith, albeit a slightly pudgy one, due to a steady pilfering of his father's pies. And in the safety of my master's shop, away from the horrors of battle like death, pain, or even a mild scolding, Tom's courage held no equal. He glared at the inanimate bear. The floorboards creaked as he stepped within range of its wickedly curved claws. Tom shoved the curio cabinet aside, making the brass balances jingle. Then he hoisted his flour-dusted club in salute. The frozen beast roared back silently, inch-long teeth promising death. Or several minutes of tedious polishing, at least. I sat on the counter at the back, legs dangling, and tapped leather heels against the carved cedar. I could be patient. You had to be, sometimes with Tom, whose mind worked as it pleased. "Think you can steal my sheep, Mr. Bear?" he said. "I'll give you no quarter this day." Suddenly he stopped, rolling pin held outwards in mid-lunge. I could almost see the clockwork cranking between his ears.
"Wait, what?"
He looked back at me, puzzled.
"What did you say?"
"Let's build a cannon," I said.
"What does that mean?"
"Just what you think it means. You and me build a cannon. You know," I spread my hands.
"Boom."
Tom frowned.
"We can't do that."
"Why not?"
"Because people can't just build cannons, Christopher."
He said it like he was explaining why you shouldn't eat fire to a small, dull child.
"But that's where cannons come from," I said. "People build them. You think God sends cannons down from heaven for Lent?"
"You know what I mean." I folded my arms. I don't understand why you're not more excited about this. Maybe that's because you're never the one on the pointy end of your schemes. What schemes? I don't have any schemes. I spent all night throwing up that strength potion you invented, he said. He did look a little dark under the eyes today. Ah, yes. Sorry, I winced. I think I put in too much black snail. It needed less snail. What it needed was less Tom. Don't be such a baby, I said. Vomiting's good for you anyway. It balances the humours. I like my humours the way they are, he said. But I have a recipe this time. I grabbed the parchment I'd leaned against the coin scales on the countertop and waved it at him. A real one, from Master Benedict. How can a cannon have a recipe? Not the whole cannon, just the gunpowder. Tom went very still. He scanned the jars around him, as if among the hundreds of potions, herbs and powders that ring the shop was a remedy that would somehow get him out of this. That's illegal. Knowing a recipe isn't illegal, I said. Making it is. That was true. Only masters and only those with a royal charter were allowed to mix gunpowder. I was a long way from either. And Lord Ashcombe is on the streets today, Tom said. Now that made me pause. You saw him? Tom nodded. On Cheapside, after church. He had two of the king's men with him. What'd he look like? Mean? Mean was exactly what I'd imagined. Lord Richard Ashcombe, Baron of Chillingham, was King Charles's loyal general and His Majesty's warden here in London. He was in the city hunting for a pack of killers. In the past 4 months, 5 men had been butchered in their homes. Each of them had been tied up, tortured, then slit open at the stomach and left to bleed to death. 3 of the victims had been apothecaries, a fact that had me seeing assassins in the shadows every night. No one was sure what the killers wanted, but sending in Lord Ashcombe meant the king was serious about stopping them. Lord Ashcombe had a reputation for getting rid of men hostile to the crown, usually by sticking their heads on pikes in the public square. Still, we didn't need to be that cautious. Lord Ashcombe's not coming here, I said, as much to myself as to Tom. We haven't killed anyone, and the king's warden isn't likely to stop by for a suppository, is he?
What about your master? Tom said.
He doesn't need a suppository. Tom made a face.
I mean, isn't he coming back?
It's getting close to dinner time. He said dinner time with a certain wistfulness. Master Benedict just bought the new edition of Culpepper's Herbal, I said. He's at the coffee house with Hugh. They'll be gone for ages. Tom pressed his ceramic shield to his chest.
This is a bad idea.
I hopped down from the counter and grinned. To be an apothecary, you must understand this. The recipe is everything. It isn't like baking a cake. The potions, creams, jellies and powders Master Benedict made, with my help, required an incredibly delicate touch. A spoonful too little nitre, a pinch too much aniseed, and your brilliant new remedy for dropsy would congeal instead into worthless green goo. But new recipes didn't fall from the sky. You had to discover them. This took weeks, months, even years of hard work. It cost a fortune too. Ingredients, apparatus, coal to stoke the fire, ice to chill the bath. Most of all, it was dangerous. Blazing fires, molten metals, elixirs that smelled sweet but ate away your insides, tinctures that looked as harmless as water but threw off deadly invisible fumes. With each new experiment, you gambled with your life, so a working formula was better than gold. If you could read it. Arrow down, M08, arrow to the right, 02160911101, 825-261-31009, 261122213, 15,
24030321321415107120321412100415120124170920912120924198049.
Tom scratched his cheek. I thought there'd be more words and things.
It's in code, I said. He sighed. Why is it always in code?
Because other apothecaries would do anything to steal your secrets. When I have my own shop, I said proudly, I'm putting everything in code. No one's going to swipe my recipes.
No one will want your recipes, except poisoners, I suppose.
I said I was sorry.
Maybe this is in code, Tom said, because Master Benedict doesn't want anyone to read it. And by anyone, I mean you.
He teaches me new ciphers every week.
Did he teach you this one?
I'm sure he planned to.
Christopher.
But I figured it out. Look, I pointed at the notion. Down arrow, M08 right arrow. It's a substitution cipher. Every two numbers stand for one letter. This tells you how to swap them. Start with 08 and replace it with M. Then count forward, so 08 is M, 09...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.